Moonstruck Romeo sings the streets a serenade, laying everybody low with the love song that he made. He finds a street light, steps out of the shade, says something like, "You and me, babe, how about it?" Juliet says, "Hey, it's Romeo. He nearly gave me a heart attack. He's underneath the window. Hey, love, my boyfriend's back. He shouldn't come around here singing up at people like that. Anyway, what's he gonna do about it?" Juliet, the dice was loaded from the start in my bed. When you exploded in my heart, both mean, yeah, and the dream was just the same. Then I dreamed your dream for you, and now your dream is real. How can you look at me as if I was just another one of your deals? You can fall for chains of silver, you can fall for chains of gold, you can fall for pretty strangers and the promises they hold. You promised me everything, promise me thick and thin, yeah. Now you just say, "Oh, Romeo, yeah, you know, I used to have a scene with him." Juliet,
when I love you, you used to cry.
Then I love you like the stars above, and love you till I die. And there's a place for us. You know that movie song.
When you're gonna realize, and it's just that the time is wrong.
Talk like the talk on the TV. I can't do a love song like the way it's meant to be. I can't do everything, but I'd do anything for you. I can't do anything to be in love with you. And all I do is miss you in the way we used to be. And all I do is keep the beat and bad company, and all I do is kiss you through the bars of a rhyme. Juliet, I do the stars with you anytime. Juliet,
when love used to cry, I said I love you like the stars above. I love you till I die.
Something like, "You and me, babe, how about it?"
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Catalyst. My name is JR. I'm the teaching pastor here. And as we're beginning this morning, I wanted to share, it was a couple of weeks ago now, that my wife and I went to see, with one of our good friends, a Shakespeare in the Park performance of Romeo and Juliet, which was actually the first time I had ever seen a full production of the play. I missed the Baz Luhrmann adaptation in the 90s that apparently everyone else saw and enjoyed. So I was struck, like I'd always kind of, you know, known the story, basically, but I was really struck by the fact that we hold Romeo and Juliet up as one of like the greatest love stories of all time, but it's not actually a love story. If you know the plot, if you don't know the plot, I'll just tell you real quick. So Romeo and Juliet are two teens that live in Verona, Italy, and they meet at a party and instantly fall in love. And what I mean by that is that they both think the other one is hot, right? Because that's literally all they know about each other. And so that sends Romeo pining away for the rest of Act One, figuring out how he can possibly be with this woman that has so captivated him. And to the play's credit, like five different characters try to explain to Romeo that he is not in love, that this is just infatuation, puppy love, lust, something like that. He doesn't listen because, you know, teenage boy. So they eventually meet, they exchange some poetry, which in their defense was much better than any of the poetry that I wrote in high school, so they did have that going for them. Everyone in the play is against them being together, which if you've ever been young and in love, you know that it can feel that way sometimes, that the whole world's against you, that no one understands your love quite like you do. So I think the play taps into some of those feelings that we've probably all experienced at some point or another. And then because they can't be together, they come up with this elaborate plan to fake their own deaths and escape together. And then there's some miscommunication, and they end up both dying by suicide because they both think the other one is dead. When if they had all just, like, waited a minute or two, right, this could have all been avoided. And one of the things I love about the cover that we opened with, it was originally by Dire Straits, we did the version by The Killers, is that it imagines that they had just waited a moment or two, right? That in fact, Romeo and Juliet do end up getting to be together, and then it speculates that what happened to their infatuation, what happened to their young puppy love, is what so often happens to infatuation and puppy love. You know, you have a conversation or two that's about something other than how hot you each are and how much the world's against you. And you might realize you don't have as much in common as you thought, or that your values don't quite align, or for some reason this isn't working for one or the other person. And then they just sort of go their separate ways. And so, that, you know, in the song, Romeo is sort of moping around, stepping out of convenient streetlights and trying to win Juliet back, and she's moved on. You know, the love just sort of fizzled. I think it's easy for us, if we sort of take a step back from a story like Romeo and Juliet, to recognize that it's not really love. That in fact, feelings, emotions that cause us to do the things that Romeo and Juliet do in the play are not truly loving. Compare Romeo and Juliet, for instance, to the first few minutes of the Pixar movie Up, where we get sort of a montage of the life of Carl and Ellie, right? And we see them have the same sort of Romeo and Juliet meet and fall in love moment. And then we watch them live a long life together that's full of beautiful high moments and of really difficult and tragic low moments. When this movie first came out, people were sort of jokingly commenting how Pixar is setting out to ruin everyone's day with just the 7 minutes of the opening of a movie. Because it's such a powerful experience to watch these people live and love together. And we watch, you know, a short little thing that actually doesn't even have any dialogue in it, right? Like Up, and we say, that is true love. It may not be perfect love, right? But there's something about the relationship between those two that it feels much more deep and authentic than what we see between Romeo and Juliet. And so I bring all of that up today because I want us to spend some time considering what love is not. This is actually a philosophical practice that goes all the way back to Aristotle, who says that, you know, some things like God, like love, are difficult, if not impossible, for us to describe. And so one of the ways that we can sort of get at least headed in the right direction of what love is by talking about the things that love is not, and by experiencing and considering the things in our culture that we often mistake for love that, in fact, are not truly loving. And so that's what we're going to do today. We're going to spend some time talking about the things that love is not, to hopefully point all of us together towards the one who is perfectly loving, the one from whom we learn to love. And so we're going to begin today by worshiping God and by celebrating the love that God has for us and how God brings us to life and makes us live lives that are full of love. So I want to encourage all of us today, if you're with us, to participate with us. If you're here in person with us, that means, you know, you can stand up, clap, sing with us. If you're online, please also consider doing that as well. Utilize the live chat. Those of you who are here in person with us, feel free to have YouTube open on your phone so you can be connecting with the folks who are online as well. And of course, obviously, we're going to be receiving communion later. So if you're in the building, hopefully you got one of the little cups on the way in. If you're at home, please gather some stuff so that you'll be ready to do that at the end of our gathering together. And with that, I want to pass this over to Nathan and the worship team to lead us. So would you stand with me?
Good morning, y'all. Hey. Good morning. John, Lily, and Chanel and I are very, very excited that you're here with us, whether in person or on the internet, connecting with us. And we're going to sing some songs together. So y'all are already standing. Good job. If you're at home, you should feel a little bit more free to move around and dance because you got all that space. So here I'm going to encourage you, if you're here with us right now, feel free to move, clap your hands, do a little dip. We're going to sing this song together.
Can take. before. I want to sing a little louder than before. I want to jump higher than before. I want to shout louder. So everybody shout freedom, 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 freedom. I want to clap a little louder than before. Sing a little louder than before. I want to spin wilder than before. I want to shout loud. Everybody say freedom. No more chains, no more bondage. I am free. Yeah. If you know that, sing that with us. No more shackles, no more chains, no more bondage. I am free. Yeah. No more shackles, no more shackles, no more chains, no more bondage. I am free, yeah. We're gonna dance, dance of freedom and say hallelujah,
hallelujah, hallelujah.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that there are no more shackles, there's no more chains, there's no more bondage. We are free. Your Spirit has set us free. You have set us free. We're no longer captives. We're no longer held down and tied down by the things of this world, by our own desires, by anything. You have given us freedom, and we rejoice in that, and we rejoice in you. We ask this in your son's Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You can all have a seat. As we are continuing to worship, I just wanted to say thank you to all of you here in the congregation who have continued to support the church financially throughout the pandemic, and especially those of you who contributed to our giving campaigns, our Closing the Building Gap campaign, and our soccer field campaign. We've been doing great with those, and I just want to say thank you. Again, I know a lot of us had to stretch to go above and beyond, and so I just want to say thank you for that. Thank you so much. Now, this is the time in our gathering when kids, you will head back to the lab. This is where you will get to hear about what love is not in language that is right at your age level. Same thing we do in here, just with Miss Vanessa, so it's more fun. So thank you, kids. We're going to have you head on out. And as they're going, I want to invite all of you adults to pass peace with me. This is, again, something we do every week because we know that peace comes from God through us. And so if you're online with us, please feel free to utilize the chat and also, of course, to text selfies or find a funny GIF or something like that. If you're in person, please consider elbows or long-distance high fives. And then also, please, again, don't forget to reach out to some folks that are virtual with us or who aren't here this week, is missing their face. Send a text or a GIF or something like that as well. So let's take a couple minutes to pass peace together as we continue to worship. Peace be with all of you.
Come on, let's have a soul party. Turn yourself loose. Well, if I told you once, yeah. I'm gonna tell you twice. Yeah. You're driving me crazy, baby.
Oh, baby.
But oh, that's nice.
Oh, that's nice.
I'm gonna tell you twice.
Good time.
Just like I told you once. Let me see you clap your hands. I'm gonna see my baby.
Thank you.
in a series for the next couple of months called Journey to Love, which we're following the book Journey to Love by our good friend Matt Michaelotis. And this series is all about how we can live lives that are filled with more love, how we can be people who show more love, and also how we can be people who receive love better. We began a couple of weeks ago when Matt actually was with us and invited us to prepare for the journey, to consider what it looks like for us to have more love in our lives and to be ready to be transformed. Last week, we started by looking at where love is, and we saw some of the fruit of love and considered the idea that when we find that fruit around us in our lives, we can stay in those places and then hopefully find the root of love that it's growing from. And so this week, we're going to talk about what love is not. What are some of the places that when we see those things in our lives, they're places that we need to avoid, or maybe places where we need to slow down and investigate why these things that are not love, that so often masquerade as love, are growing in our lives. What is different that needs to change? And so I wanted to begin with a quote from the novel Anna Karenina, which came out in 1877 in Russia. It's by Leo Tolstoy. This is a quote that I first heard, I don't even know how long ago, but it's kind of haunted me. So the book opens with this sentence: all happy families are alike. Each unhappy family is unhappy in its own way. Now, I do that because I think when we're talking about love, this can be true for us. I think all of us live lives that are unloving in different ways. Another way I like to say this is that we're all dysfunctional in our own ways. Love tends to always look like love wherever you find it, but dysfunction and unlove look different everywhere. And for reasons that are going to be really important for us this morning, I think it's a lot easier for us to spot in other people. So, for instance, you might have a friend whose family is really critical, and you notice this when you're around your friend and their family. You notice that they all just snipe at each other and that their words are constantly tearing each other down. And you think to yourself, wow, that's really unloving. But your friend maybe doesn't seem to spot it. Or maybe you have a coworker who's really jealous, and they're always, the way they're talking about their romantic partner is pretty gross. And you can hear it and you can see it, but again, in their own mind, they seem to consider themselves to be really loving. Or maybe you know someone who has a temper, right? And you see the way people are constantly walking on eggshells around them. And again, they don't seem to spot that or notice that, but it's really clear to you. We're really good, I think, at spotting unlove in other people. It's harder for us, and I think that's because of this quote, right? The way we have grown up is normal to us. No matter how dysfunctional it is in reality, no matter how unloving it is in reality, it feels normal to us, and it feels like love to us. And so it can be really hard for us to see it in ourselves. So what I want to do this morning is spend some time working through some places in Scripture that are identified as unloving, and I want to invite you to listen with me and use it as sort of a mirror that will hold up and sort of reflect back to us what love looks like, what love doesn't look like. And I have a suspicion that we'll all see ourselves reflected in the mirror of unlove, probably all in different ways, right? But it's a chance for us to do some honest self-reflection together. So if you have a Bible, go ahead and turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. If you grabbed one of the Bibles out of the back, that's on page 691. And if you don't own a Bible, please keep that one considered a gift from us. Now, some of you, your ears are tingling because when I said 1 Corinthians 13, you were like, wait, is it a wedding today? Is that what's happening? Who's getting married, right? This is one of the go-to verses that people love to read at weddings, and rightfully so, because it's about love. But one thing, this was actually growing up in the church, this was kind of one of those big light bulb moments for me. I had always heard 1 Corinthians 13. I'd even read it as a wedding text. I think I was actually in college before I said, you know what, this letter is not actually about marriage. Paul does talk about marriage at one point earlier in 1 Corinthians, but there he says Christians shouldn't get married unless they just can't control themselves. That's like the only thing Corinthians says about marriage. This passage is not about romantic love, or I should say it's not about only romantic love. Paul is convinced, as I hope we should be, that love is not limited to romantic relationships. It's certainly not limited to marriage. Love is much bigger than that and encompasses all people. All of us, regardless of our relationship status, should have lives that are full of love and that are overflowing, both giving and receiving love. It doesn't matter whether we're married or single, dating someone, it doesn't matter any of that, right? Love is not a function of relationship status for Paul. This passage is to a church full of people like us, right? And so as I read this, I want you to kind of bear that in mind, that what Paul is describing here is not limited to romantic partners. So I'm going to read the whole passage for us, that it's only like three verses that we're focusing on today. And then I want to go back and kind of work through the list one thing at a time, slowly just kind of talk about what each of them is. And again, the goal here is not that I think none of us knows the definition of these words. It's more of a chance for us to slow down and use these as a mirror to look at our own lives and say, where are some spots that we are maybe unloving that we didn't even realize it? Right, because for us, it was just normalized. So let's begin reading in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Then again, we'll come back and work through them. So Paul says, love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It is not irritable, and it keeps no record of being wronged. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up. Never loses faith, is always hopeful, and endures through every circumstance. Okay, again, that's just a handful of verses. It's not even all of that 1 Corinthians 13 says about love. You're going to read that later in the week. But there's so many things here. And of course, it starts out with, right, love is patient. That's not a thing love is not. That's a thing love is. Right? Love takes its time. Love holds space for other people. Right? Love doesn't get impatient when things don't happen according to our own timeline. And love is kind. This is important. We're going to come back to it later a little bit too, but so often in our culture, we mistake niceness for kindness, right? Niceness is superficial. Niceness, in fact, often, niceness, we know this because we're in the South, right? So we have Texas nice, which is often actually not very kind, right? Texas nice is where we just pretend to like someone for the sake of keeping the peace and not offending, but there's actually no deep, good relationship there. And so Paul says love is kind, right? Which is a way of saying that love treats other people like family, even if they aren't. Love does not settle for a shallow, superficial calm when there is not peace. Okay, and that's hard for us. Now, here are the things that Paul says love is not, right? Love is not jealous. I have yet to encounter jealousy that is not deeply rooted in insecurity. And so when a jealous person expresses that jealousy, what they're saying is, I don't feel comfortable and safe. I know times in my life when I've been jealous, what that means is I don't feel good right now. And so whereas love is focused on the other, which we looked at last week, right? Jealousy is focused on myself. How do you need to change to assuage and assure me? And that's not love. That's selfishness. That's anti-love. That's why Paul says love is not jealous. In a similar vein, he says love is not boastful, right? A boastful person is calling attention to themselves. They're saying, look at me. Look at my accomplishments. Look at my achievements. And again, this is almost always a function of insecurity. I don't feel as if I am getting enough attention, acclaim, recognition, whatever. And so I am calling attention. I am saying again, please make me feel better. Please make me feel bigger. Please make me feel more successful. But again, when someone is communicating boastfully, it's about themselves, right? It's not about other people. And so Paul says that's not loving. Love is not proud, which is so similar to boastfulness, right? The proud is putting myself first, believing I'm better than other people. We even sort of have mapped pride onto a vertical axis. When you're proud, you're looking down at people, right? So you've put yourself above as though you're better than other people. This is maybe sort of the opposite of insecurity, right? This is maybe hypersecurity, like we've overinflated how good I feel about myself and devalued other people in the process. And love is not rude. I spent a lot of time, like when I was going through this list, trying to differentiate among these words. Because again, I don't know about you, but like when I read these, I'm sort of like, yeah. Not love bad, love good, right? And these are all, these all sort of get mixed in together as like not good stuff. But I tried to slow down and think about times in my life when I've been rude, when other people have been rude to me. And again, I think it's different enough from pride to warrant its own spot on this list. I think when we're rude, we tend to dehumanize other people. Like I know one of the places we often see rudeness is in the customer service industry, right? And I think when someone is rude to a server, right, or something like that, what we're seeing is that we're not treating that person as a person. We're treating them as a product, right? The person who, the thing that is getting the food to my table, or the thing that is getting the drink in my hand, right? And I don't have to treat them as a human. I don't have to be kind to them. I don't have to acknowledge their humanity because they're just a thing providing a service to me. And so rudeness is maybe even like a worse extension of pride because I'm not just looking down on another person. I'm stripping away their humanity and acting as though they don't exist to me or that they exist only to provide for me. You know, it's commodifying other people. And again, I think when we see someone who's rude or proud or boastful, it's easy for us to say, well, that's not love, right? Love doesn't treat other people that way. Love does not demand its own way. I couldn't help but think about so many of my friends who are not part of the church right now, who in all of the endless debates about masks and all of that kind of stuff have expressed dismay that so often the people who are most loudly insisting that they should be able to do whatever they want are us, evangelicals. The ones most loudly trumpeting about our own rights are people who follow Jesus, who are told right here, love does not demand its own way. Love looks out for the good of other people. Love is happy to make sacrifices for the good of others, because that's what love does. And I've seen a lot of anger, right? But as we talk about a lot here at Catalyst, often what's under anger is hurt. Hurt that those of us who are supposed to be the most loving, who are supposed to be showing the world who Jesus is, are so often actually the ones doing the opposite, insisting on our own way, often to the detriment of others. And again, a number of my friends who are outside of the church look at that and say, I don't know what that is, but it's not love. Paul goes on to say, love is not irritable. Which again, irritable is really about being on our own timetables, right? I tend to get the most irritated when the world doesn't act the way I think the world should. When people don't behave according to my wishes and desires, when things don't operate according to my timeline, right? And so it's easy for me to get irritable. Whereas again, love puts other people first and says, you know what? The world doesn't revolve around me. And other people don't organize their lives around what I like or dislike. And so I can let those things go and receive other people as they are rather than as I want them to be. Love keeps no record of being wronged. I've heard people say, I'll forgive, but I'll never forget. And that's not loving. In fact, that actually can be abusive because what happens in those relationships is anytime I get angry, then I can trot out the whole list of things that you've ever done to wrong me, right? Even if we've already settled accounts, even if I've already apologized for those things and done my best to make amends, I stay on that list because that person keeps a record of being wronged, right? And then anytime I do something that is not in accordance with this other person's wishes, the whole list comes back out. Paul says, look, love doesn't keep record of being wrong. Now, I want to pause here because it can sound like here Paul is saying love tolerates abuse, right? Love doesn't insist on change, that if I do something that hurts you and then I apologize, then I can just do that thing again and hurt you again and then apologize again and over and over and over in an endless cycle, because after all, love doesn't keep record of wrongs, right? Well, I would remind you that one of the first things that we looked at today is love is kind. And again, kindness is not the same thing as niceness, right? Kindness doesn't settle for a superficial calm when there's a deep problem. And repeated wrongs, repeated hurts, repeated injuries are abuse. And one of the most important things I ever learned from people who work in justice work, people like civil rights leaders and activists and things like that, is that injustice is always hurtful both to the victim and to the victimizer. Right? When you abuse another person, it is bad for, of course it's bad for the person you're abusing, right? That's not up for debate. But it's also bad for us. When I dehumanize another person, it also dehumanizes me. And so it is loving and kind to point that out to the abuser so that they can stop participating in that abusive, unjust behavior. And again, that's why I insisted earlier that calm or that nice and kind are different, because that's not going to feel good. It's going to feel scary for the person speaking up, and it's not going to feel good for the person who's being called out on their behavior. Right? So I'm trying to inject a lot more nuance than Paul was in this list, because Paul was trying to be poetic, right? And I'm trying to be a little more didactic. But when we say love keeps no record of wrongs, of being wronged, that is assuming that there has been genuine repentance and restoration in the relationship. That's a different thing from when there is an ongoing, persistent pattern of abuse. That needs to be addressed, and there needs to be genuine repentance before the possibility of reconciliation can be explored, right? And that's a whole, like, we could do a whole series on that, and I think we have before, right? But suffice to say now, assuming in our relationships that we have gotten to the place where we can name injustice, name sin, name abuse, have genuine repentance from that and reconciliation. If that can be had, then yeah, we need to let that thing go. We need to release it, and it needs to not be in the list of evils that we pull out every time the other person does something we don't like. We should not keep an ongoing notebook of all of the ways people that we love have offended us in the past. That's not loving. Paul goes on to say that love does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Again, I could not help but think about how deeply this speaks to our culture right now, a culture that is filled with so many competing voices about what counts as true and how much that's linked to injustice. How deeply the things we believe to be true are shaping how we interact with our neighbors. Because again, justice, as we've talked about at Catalyst before, justice is what love looks like in public. And you can follow it, right, from what people say they believe to be true to how they treat their neighbors. And so Paul says, look, love does not rejoice when there's injustice. Love does not rejoice when people are dehumanized. Love does not rejoice when entire communities do not have access to the same rights and privileges that other communities have. Love does not rejoice at those things. Instead, love rejoices when the truth wins out, which again, by implication, means we should be a people who loves truth, who cares about what is true, who cares about how we know what is true. Christians ought to be the people who are the best at knowing what truth is and celebrating that. And yet a report that was released a couple of years ago from MIT showed that all of the top 10 most popular Christian Facebook pages that people liked and interacted with were run by Russian troll farms. And then Guidepost Magazine, which is a real one, was number 11. So hanging in there. Let down. Good for Guidepost, right? Just honored to be on the list. But I was deeply grieved when I saw that, right? Because, again, we who are called to love truth, who are supposed to follow the one who is the way, the truth, and the life, are rejoicing, celebrating, sharing things that are created to do us harm. And we seem to be unable or unwilling to differentiate between those things. And Paul says it should not be that way. That's not love, and that's not loving. Paul closes with three statements that I think are just so powerful. Four statements. Love never gives up, right? Love never loses faith. Is always hopeful and endures through every circumstance. These are difficult things for us these days. It's easy to become hopeless. It's easy to want to throw in the towel. It's easy to believe that our best days are behind us. And yet Paul says love does the opposite. Love is convinced that the best days are ahead of us and that we can endure. That's what love does. And so if God is love and God is in us, that's what we can do. Now, I want to hang out with that for just a second. I'm willing to bet that all of us felt called out at some point in that list. I'm sure we're all probably better at thinking about people that we want to send the sermon to, right? Oh, so-and-so needs to hear this. Yeah. Whatever, right? Sure they do. But I hope we all also felt something personally, right? That God was speaking to us and saying, this is an area where maybe you did not even realize you were not loving. And yet, when Paul said, this is what love looks like, and this is what love is not, and you said, oh no, I'm on the wrong side of that. Now, I said earlier that it's really difficult for us to see that. And so that's a gift of Scripture, right, that can give us this list. But I think it's important that Paul wrote this to a church like ours, a church community. And I think one of the important realizations about that is that Paul expected us to live together, to work through this list together, to practice loving together, because relationships are our best vehicle for learning to love better. And I don't just mean romantic relationships, familiar relationships. That's true. I mean, intimate relationships are really good at helping us learn to love better. Amanda and I, when we got married, when we were dating, we learned that our families fight really differently, right? That we love and resolve conflict to love better really differently. My family is the knockdown, drag-out, screaming matches, right? Her family is the never, ever, ever, ever talk about it ever, ever, even if you're like in danger of losing a limb, right? And so we had to fight about fighting before we could even fight, because we didn't even know what we were doing when we were coming together. And I thought the way I was engaging her was loving. I was getting everything out on the table and all that. And she thought the way she was engaging me was loving, because like she was never bringing painful things to my attention, right? And so we actually had to learn that both of us were not very good at loving through conflict. And we had to get better at that. So intimate relationships are good for that. If you're willing to put in the work, right, they're good for that. But again, love is not dependent on your relationship status. And so that's why the church community is called together to be together. Through Catalyst, I've learned how to be more patient, right, pastorally. I've learned how to be more humble. Through Catalyst, I've learned how to be more faith-filled and hope-filled and endure through every circumstance. Being a part of this church family has taught me how to love better. And I hope that's true for you too. It's one of the reasons, again, our C groups are so valuable, because when we are willing to spend that time together, really sharing our lives with each other, we can learn how to love better. We can see the spaces in our lives that are actually unloving that we didn't even know about, because we need friends to show us the difference. Tolstoy said, every happy family is the same, and every unhappy family is unhappy in their own way. Again, just to riff on that this morning, I would say we all, when we are loving in the same ways. But everyone who is unloving in different ways. And the beauty of being a church that is called together to be a church family is that we can learn together how to love. and how to love well. So I want to move into a time of response. We're moving towards the communion table. And for the prayer of examine today, I wanted to do something a little different. Instead of asking you some questions, I'm gonna have Ashley put up just the whole scripture that we worked through together. And I'm going to give you about 3 minutes of silence. And again, silence is relative, right? So if you're with people you need to talk about it with, that's fine. You can talk and just please do that quietly. Or you can just reflect prayerfully and reflectively work through the list again. Or if there's something that as I was working through it, it like pinged you, you can go and hang out with that phrase or that space. And I want you to just spend a few minutes with God, asking God to show you ways that you are unloving, and then considering what it looks like for you to live a more loving life in this next week. So, after we've done that, I'll pray for all of us together, and then we'll come to the communion table, which is the table that Jesus sets for us. As we talked about last week, our journey to love begins with God loving us first. And so we receive communion as a way of saying yes to God, so that we can live lives that are more loving. So here again is 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 through 7. I'm going to give you a few minutes of silence, and then again, I'll pray for all of us. Let's pray together. God, you have gathered us here today that we might hear all of these different ways that are not loving, that frankly are so easy for us to mistake for love because of the way we've grown up, the things that seem normal to us, because we live in a world where it's so easy not to love. Thank you for giving us these words that, again, are so powerful that they shape the way we want to love, that they have become for our culture an ideal that we hold up even in our marriage ceremonies. And yet we have heard today as we've slowed down and tried to receive these more deliberately, you've held them up to us as a mirror to show us ways where we are unloving, ways where we need to be changed, where we need to be transformed. And so because of that, we come to your table today to receive these elements. We pray that as we receive these wafers and this juice or whatever we've been able to bring together with us, that you would make them a spiritual food, that we might yet again be remade into your body and know yet again how much you love us and that that love might transform us in these spaces that you've shown us today. Thank you for the gift of one another so that we can learn to be more loving together. And we offer these prayers this morning, and we approach your table in the name of your son, Jesus. The night Jesus was betrayed, he shared a meal with his disciples. And at that meal, he broke bread, he gave it to them, and he said, "This is my body broken for you, take it and eat it." When the meal was finished, he gave them a cup of wine. He said, "This is my blood poured out for the forgiveness of sins, take it and drink it." And so we too eat and drink, and as we do, we announce Jesus' death until he returns. Catalyst, as you're going this week, I want to say thank you to all of our volunteers who are helping us to create this space week after week after week. Thank you for your continued faithfulness in that. And I want to give you an assignment. So if you've been reading Journey to Love, you know every day Matt has an exercise for us to practice being more loving or receiving love better. And one of the ones that is in the week that's ahead of us and this week about what love is not is about anger. And so I wanted to give you that as an assignment this week, just because, again, I think it's something we're seeing a lot in our world. So there's a couple different ways you can go with this. If you're an angry person, if you're someone that you find other people are walking on eggshells around you, I want you to just pay attention to your anger and see how often the cause of that anger is something that is righteous anger. And if you don't know, well, that probably tells you something. Maybe spend some time with it. Investigate that. If you're someone who is in a relationship with an angry person, again, whether that's a spouse or a romantic partner, or it could be a boss or someone, you know, in your extended family, and they are an angry person, I just want you to watch when that person gets angry and what causes that. And I don't want you to have to feel like you have to do anything about it. You don't have to say anything about it. You don't have to do anything. You certainly don't have to change your behavior. I just want you to be attentive to those things. And again, see what we learn when we pay closer attention to that in our world. Because again, I think being able to spot what love is not can be really helpful. So now if you'll stand, Catalyst, I want to send you with a blessing today. As you're going, I want to encourage you. We did a big list today of the things love is not, and it's easy to feel beat up or overwhelmed when we consider how much work we have to do in our journey of transformation. But I want to encourage you and remind you that our journey is all grounded in God's love for us, in what God has already done for us, and what God promises to continue to do in us. So the things that God has shown you to do today, you do not have to do on your own. In fact, you can't do on your own. We get to do them under the leadership and the guidance of the Holy Spirit, the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead. So as you go today, would you go in that power, knowing that the same God who has called you is faithful to continue to complete that work? Go in the grace and peace of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We'll see you next week.